huge ice floe that seemed to have a mind of its own. Maybe it was actually an iceberg that was being worked on by currents down deeper. It came working its way through the pack, and it got against the port bow quarter of the ship, and it started to bend her heavy timbers as if they were bamboo. And then, suddenly, miraculously, unexplainably, that floe split right down the middle, and one half went to one side of the ship, and one half went to the other side, and left the ship unharmed. Early in October, the ice was very, very active. Many, many leads of water were starting to become visible, not big enough to get the ship into, but it seemed really clear that the breakup was happening. On October 16th, Shackleton ordered them to light the boiler fires and raise steam so that they would be able to get underway if a good lead of open water should develop. But the very next day, the 17th, all those leads of open water froze over and it snowed and filled them in. On the next day, October 18th, there was a lot of pressure against the ship and the ice started to squeeze the ship from both sides. And then, all in the space of about 5 seconds, all hell broke loose, and the ship began to roll and roll and roll and roll and roll, and men and dogs and sledges and equipment and stores went flying down the angled surface of her deck. A huge ice floe had gotten a hold of the bulge in her starboard side, and it just rolled and rolled and rolled and rolled the ship over until it came to an angle of 30 degrees. And there it stopped. McNeish had to nail cleats to the angled surface of the deck so that the men could walk up and down and try and sort out all the equipment and stuff that had slid down to the downhill side. The men took their supper that night sitting on the angled deck, holding their plates in their laps, resting their heels against those cleats, looking for all the world like men in a grandstand, you know, stadium seating. And then at 8 o'clock that night, that huge floe retreated and the Endurance righted itself and came level. Then there was no pressure on the 19th, the 20th, the 21st, or the 22nd. On the 23rd, the barometer dropped and the wind swung around 180 degrees. And on the 24th, the pressure returned. Two huge floes pinned the Endurance fore and aft on her starboard side, and another huge floe got against her midships on the port side, and they started to bend the ship the way that you would bend a stick of firewood over your knee, trying to break it. And heavy, heavy, heavy timbers started to creak and groan and then snap with a sound like artillery fire, and down in the boiler room, iron plates an inch and a quarter thick started to bend and buckle, and then there was this awful grinding, scraping sound, and her stern post was torn out, and water started to pour into the ship. The men worked at the pumps for 3 days. Chippy McNeish worked down in the hold trying to build a cofferdam just about 10 feet forward of that spot where the water was coming in, standing in water and frozen icy water up to his knees for 28 hours straight, building this dam and caulking the boards with strips of torn blanket. The men worked at the pumps in shifts of 15 minutes, 15 minutes at the pumps, 15 minutes helping McNeish, 15 minutes at the pumps, 15 minutes helping McNeish. The cofferdam slowed the flow of water into the ship, but it couldn't stop it. The next day, the men worked the pumps in shifts of an hour on and an hour off, hour on, hour off. Late in the day, the pressure increased, and the men wrote that the sound of the ice scraping against the ship was like the sound of a wounded animal screaming in pain. Shackleton ordered every man to gather up his warmest clothes and to keep them in a small bundle and close to hand in case they should have to make a hasty departure from the ship. And he ordered them to begin lowering the lifeboats and the sledges and the stores and equipment and supplies down onto the ice, onto the seemingly more stable portion of the floe on the starboard side of the ship. And while they were doing this, a very, very strange thing happened. a group of 8 or 10 emperor penguins came walking over the ice. And they stood there just a little ways out from the ship, and they just stood there watching the men lowering their stuff down onto the ice. And then, even though no one had ever heard an emperor penguin make anything other than this kind of short, hoarse croaking sound, these penguins lifted their bills to the sky and they uttered this weird, eerie, mournful cry, almost as if they were singing a funeral dirge for the tortured ship. They worked the pumps all that night and all the next day. Late in the day, late in the afternoon on the 27th, big blocks of ice started to pile up on top of each other right in front of the ship, and they climbed up onto her bows, and the weight of that ice pushed her head down, and the water started to run forward. And at 5 p.m. on October 27th, 1915, Shackleton gave the order to abandon ship.